Well, good afternoon again. Thank you for staying. I'll try not to keep you too long this afternoon. I'm sure we're tired from that meal. I had this potato soup thing that it was just very good. Whoever brought that, thank you. And if you're like us, you have a house probably with a Christmas tree that's just begging to come down, and that's probably how you will, if you're like me, spend your Sunday afternoon. Although, now that my wife has the flu, I have to go, she informed me this morning, grocery shopping alone. Now, that may not mean much to you. Let me explain. I've had Lauren in my life, either as a wife, a fiance, or a girlfriend, for 10 years now. I went grocery shopping twice before I started dating her. So I have to go back 10 years to think, when was the last time I went shopping alone, where she, and I don't mean she just sent me to get milk. I can do that. I mean, she sends me with a list that's as long as the receipt I'm going to have to print out, or they're going to give to me, I mean. Then I have to pick out all these items. I have to get the particular kind of brand, the off-brand of this, the name brand of that. I'm getting scared. Y'all pray for me, please. Because I've got to go to Harps, and I've got to do this alone. So if you happen to run into me at Harps, you know, if you're going to be there, I might just start following you and have you be my wife while I'm there. So please go to Harps, is what I'm saying. Yeah. I'll see you there. It's the end of the year. That, as we think about the end of the year, I said this morning, it brings to mind kind of the sense of finality. Even though it's kind of a strange thing to me, think about it. It's a very arbitrary thing that we put significance on the turning of the calendar to a new year. Really, all it does is go from 11:59 to 12 a.m., like it does every single day that we've lived on this earth, that we will live, or beyond us, until this world ends. All it does is just change from 11:59 to 12 a.m. Every 24 hours is a brand new day, and yet we say that this is important because now it's not just a brand new day, it's not just the turning of a brand new month, which again happens 12 times a year, but this is the turning of a brand new year. But why is that such a big deal? We've had 29 years in my lifetime, a lot more, all of us put together, a lot more. We've had years long before we ever were born, Lord willing, years long after we're gone, so what does it matter that there's another year? We don't wake up from Monday to Tuesday and say, it's a brand new, I'm going to change my life, a new day, I'm going to live a new day and change all my past. We tend to save those kind of things for big days, big events. On Monday, that's when I'm going to start the diet. Or on the beginning of next month, that's when I'm going to change my sleeping habits or whatever. Or at the beginning of the year, I'm going to do this, I'm going to start this. We think of the new year as a beginning of something, and that's fine. But it also signifies the ending of something. These are the last days of 2013. And though we'll probably mess up and do it on occasion, in a few days we're supposed to start writing 2014 on the checks that we write to the grocery store when we have to go grocery shopping. So it really ultimately doesn't matter that we're changing from one year to another. But we have put significance onto it. And so therefore, we think about the end of the year, which is also the beginning of the new year. And I want to talk about that for just a few minutes this evening. Let's not just consider the beginning of something, which is a sermon next week, really. I want us to think of the ending of something. As we put our minds to, this is ending. There will never be another 2013. Let's talk about endings. We have before us the end of a year coming up. We have before us the end of the week. Always, every week, it's another Saturday. We have before us the end of the day, which is approaching here in a few hours, and certainly coming up very soon, we have coming up the end of the hour. After all, we're at the end of the year. Yesterday was the end of the week. A Saturday is still to come. Another end of the week. What are we going to do? Ask yourself at the end of this day when I pillow my head tonight. And then what will my life be with God as I close the end of this hour? That's the sermon this afternoon. First of all, at the end of the year. At the end of the year, resolve. Next week's sermon is entitled Resolutions for 2014. But really, we need to be making whatever resolutions we're going to live up to or not live up to, depending on who we are and what we're making. We need to be making those resolutions for next year right now. I will always have a few days left because it's the same reason why you don't start stretching for the race when the gun goes off. You're supposed to already have stretched. You're supposed to already be warmed up. So when the pistol fires, you can take off running. Don't make your resolutions when you wake up Wednesday, January 1st. That's Wednesday, right? When you wake up on New Year's Day, don't say, okay, here's what I'm going to do this year. Because you'll just slowly get up to doing it, and by the time you're ready to go, it's February, and you think, I'll do it next year. And that's why we never diet when we start our diets on Tuesday. We have to start them at the beginning of something. So make your resolutions now. Resolve right now. Ask yourself, as you're thinking about the end of this year, how was your 2013? Did you meet your goals that you set for yourself? Or delay? Did you meet the goals that God set for you? Or did you deny? Were you overwhelmed? Did you have too much to do, not enough hours in the day? Or you're bored, complacent, feeling unused, unwelcomed. Forget it. Doesn't matter. It's gone. It's in the past. This is December 29th. 2013 is almost over. Everything that happened, good or bad, in 2013 is done and over. Just set it aside, let it go. When you flip that calendar over, you're flipping over every good or bad thing in your life. It's a brand new day. Let it go. You can't change the mistakes you made in 2013. You can't undo any of the bad things that you did or had done to you in 2013. What you can do is close out the year resolving, I'm going to make 2014 better in every way that 2013 was lacking. As you take that inventory, how was my 2013? Well, in January this happened. Or in June, that was a bad time. I remember when this happened. You just plug in those holes of bad times by telling yourself, next year in June, it's going to be better. And then you make it better. You set the stage, and you live up to the expectations that you set for yourself and that God sets for you. Listen to Paul. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. Let's spend a few verses here for a moment. Look at Ephesians 4, verses 21 through about 24 or so. We'll start with just 4:21. Ephesians 4:21. Context, he's talking to pagans or former pagans. He's talking to people who were not, before they were Christians, Jews. They were Gentiles. They had no relationship with God. They lived in idolatry. And Paul has to write them to say, you have family members and friends and life around you that was just like your life used to be. It still is for them, but it's past for you. Make the past the past. Resolve to move forward. Look at Ephesians 4:21. If so be that you have heard him, him is Christ, and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. Now, there's more to the sentence, but just stop right there. He says, assuming that you heard Christ, heard the message of the gospel, you've been taught by, which is the word literally in, you've been taught in Christ, then your life that was before should stay in the past. Don't bring those bad things into your present. Don't put them into your future. Leave the past in the past. For these Christians, their 2013 was their past life of idolatry. Their paganism, Paul says, set it aside, is gone. Turn the calendar. My 2013 is what? Ask yourself, what's my bad thing that happened in 2013? Resolve that it won't happen again. Look at 4:22. That you put off concerning the former conversation, that means the manner of life, the former manner of life, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. It's time, he says, to turn the page. It's the end of the year. Resolve to make the next one better. Put off the past because you're saved. Saved, listen to me, saved from your sins. Not saved in your sins. Stop with the sinning business. You're saved from your sins. Stop holding on to them like an anchor. Let it go. You're saved from your sins. God gave you a new life to live. It's a new year. What is it, 72 hours away? In 72 hours, you can turn that calendar. Listen, you can turn it right now. You can turn it prematurely and say, I'm going to start brand new right now on Sunday. Living a new life. Look at 4:23. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Be renewed. Be brought to life again. The word literally is speaking metaphorically. These Christians have already been brought to life. They already had the second birth. But he says, now make it stick. Do something with that second birth. Be renewed in the spirit, the attitude of your mind. Change your inside person. How do I do that? 4:24. And that you put on the new man, which after God, which looks like God, is created in righteousness and true holiness. Look at the two components. You want to have a new life? You want to make 2014 a new year in a metaphorical sense? It starts with holiness, that's inside, and righteousness, right doing, that's outside. You have the right inside, and that changes your attitude and actions on the outside. So tell me about your 2013. How was it? Oh, there was this and that. This happened, that happened. I wish this hadn't happened. I wish I hadn't done that. Forget it. It's in the past. Time to turn it over. It's the end of the year. Number two, the end. At the end of the week, renew. Now, of course, today is Sunday. Sunday is not the end of the week. Sunday is not the weekend. Friday and Saturday is the weekend. That's why when you get your paper, the paper has it right. You get on Friday, the weekend paper. It says weekend right there. And I had a friend who used to say it should be on Saturday because Saturday and Sunday is the weekend. You can buy calendars now that makes Monday the first day of the week. Blasphemy! Today is the first day of the week. Now, it looks, I don't care what you call the day. Sunday is named for the worship of the sun. Tomorrow is Moon Day. Tuesday is Zeus Day. Wednesday is Odin the Wanderer's Day. They're just pagan names we apply to them. Whatever day you call today, you can call it Bob's Day for all I care. It's still the first day of the week. Today is right now. And at the end of the week, which was yesterday, renew to make today the right kind of day. So coming up end of the week, which is Saturn's Day, make resolve to make the next day, renewed, a new day. So at the end of the week, Renew, let me ask you a question. What were you doing last night? Don't get specific. I don't know any particular time. Just as you pillowed your head on Saturday night, what were you thinking about? I hope, if you weren't, that you'll make this a priority, make this a goal for yourself in 2014, that when you pillow your head at night on Saturday night, you are getting your mind ready to bring your thoughts to God, that you're getting your heart ready to open it up to God, that you're getting your lips ready to sing praises to God, getting your ears ready to listen to the Father as we study His Word. I hope, in other words, come Saturday, you're preparing to renew yourself to have a brand new day come Sunday. Now, I know on Saturday, we've had a whole long week of work, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, whatever it is. We have physical fatigue. So what do we do after we go home on Friday? We have Saturday. Hopefully, if there's no yard work or anything like that to do on Saturday, nobody's sick or anything, you're exhausted, you're physically tired. Your body tells you you need to take a break. So you pop up your recliner and you just relax. As long as your kids will let you relax, come Saturday. That's fine. That's what you're supposed to do. That's the weekend. Do that. What about when you're spiritually fatigued? Your body physically doesn't tell you, hey, you need to recharge your spiritual batteries, because that's not your physical body. It's the spiritual thing. You have to be told through the Bible, you need to recharge that spiritual Duracell that you have in your soul. How do you do that? On Sunday, right here, you're recharging it as you worship with your brethren. If it gets drained again, hey, we have a Wednesday night. You can recharge it early. Renew, in other words, on Saturday, that tomorrow is going to be a brand new day, and I'm going to devote it to the worship of my Father, like I'm supposed to do. We need not forget that we can be spiritually fatigued. Look at 1 Corinthians 14:15, just to give you a verse. 1 Corinthians 14:15, how we need to focus our minds on things spiritual, and if we don't, the damage that can be done. We shouldn't have to drag ourselves out of bed on Sunday morning. The alarm goes off if it's 6, 7, or 8 o'clock. We shouldn't just have to hit the snooze and lay there thinking, oh, am I going to get up and worship God today? That should not be the question we ask ourselves. I'm not saying it's a sin to wake up tired. I'm saying it's wrong to try to goad ourselves, to talk ourselves into getting up. And that should be all the highlight of our whole week. We should be striving and working toward Monday through Saturday night to this very moment, Sunday. 1 Corinthians 14:15. What is it then? Now, we're out of context a little bit, but just read it. I will pray with the Spirit. I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit. I will sing with the understanding also. Context is miraculous gifts, but the application here is you can't just sing. God doesn't want you to just pray. Come Wednesday, we're going to study Isaiah chapter 1, preview. At one point, God tells the people of Judah, stop bringing me your worship. I am sick. He actually says, I have had it up to here. I am full of your burnt offerings and sacrifices. I am tired of you people, God says, coming to me and offering your vain worship, just going through the motions, punching your ticket and going home thinking you've done your good deed, living sinfully Sunday through Friday, then on Saturday you come and you bring me your worship. God says, I'm tired of it. I've had it up to here. He says the same thing to me. If I come and I plop myself down in that comfy blue pew, and I think, all right, I'll just sing Blessed Assurance, and I don't have any heart into it at all. Oh, I'm doing all the action, but the attitude is wrong. I might as well go home, watch the Cowboys lose. Wasting my time. No, you worship God, sing with the Spirit. Sing, pray with the understanding. In other words, put the inside right. At the end of the week, renew. Come Saturday, if the Lord gives you another one, set your mind. Every Saturday night when I come up here to practice my sermon and I get everything ready for Sunday morning, I always post on the Facebook page, I'm getting ready for Sunday. Are you? Get your mind right. Renew. At the end of the week, at the end of the year, here's another one. At the end of the day, reflect. I want to ask a question. I said this about Saturday, but let's make it in general. What's the last thing you do before you go to bed? I was watching TV a few years ago, and there was a doctor on, I don't know what I was watching. It might have been, I don't even know. It wasn't Dr. Oz or somebody like that. I wouldn't watch that. It was some infomercial. Some doctor was on doing something. And this guy was talking about simple things you can do to lose weight. I'm intrigued. Simple things to lose weight. Sounds like a contradiction, but you've got my attention. And he said, one of the things you can do is don't eat anything after 7 o'clock. What else is on? I changed the channel. But that's a smart thought, right? Because what you do, your body starts slowing down and everything after 7 o'clock. And if you do, you just hold on to that and it just goes right to your thighs. That fudge, that Christmas fudge your mother makes so well. But it's true. How you spend your night affects how you wake up the next day. I'm 29. My wife's already 30. She's not here, but she doesn't care. I'm about to turn 30 in 2014. I'll be turning 30 in August. It's another one of those numbers we put arbitrary significance to. But I have noticed as I get older, a little older, that I can eat certain things and I get this burning around my heart. What is that? Is there a word for that? Didn't used to happen. I used to be able to eat Oreos stacked that tall with a milk, glass of milk stacked that high. Now I can't eat two Oreos. It's Oreos. Oreos. Now at 8 o'clock I'll eat an Oreo. 11:30 I'm up with heartburn. I don't like it, but that's what age is. What you do to your body on nighttime affects how you wake up in the morning. You ever wake up really fatigued? You went to bed too late? Or you didn't go to bed at the right time? You didn't get enough sleep and things? What do you do before you go to sleep? Pillow your head. Pray to the God who gave you that day. Let me give you a verse. Look at Lamentations. Lamentations, after the book of Jeremiah, in the Old Testament, Lamentations 3, 22 through 24. Lamentations 3, 22 through 24. I had a friend in preaching school who every morning he would get up. When some of us are dragging our feet like chimpanzees, this person would always be chipper. He'd always be excited. We'd sing, we'd go to chapel and we'd sing and we'd have a scripture before we'd go to class. And he would always walk into the school building. We'd always hear him come down the hall singing, "This is the day the Lord has made." Beautiful song, wonderful message. But when you're tired every single morning and he is chipper every single morning, it starts to grate on you. And finally we said, "What is it that you're doing? What pill are you taking that makes you so chipper every morning?" And he would say, "I sing that song to myself every night before I go to sleep. Tomorrow is the day the Lord will make. I will be glad and rejoice in it. Today was the day the Lord had made. I have rejoiced and been glad in it." And he said that put him in the right attitude. I'm sure there was something else he was doing, but it's getting a lot of sleep probably. But still, that's a good thought to have. When you pillow your head, today was the day the Lord made. Did you rejoice in it? Look at Lamentations 3, 22 through 24. Jeremiah says, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassion fail not." So, tell me if you recognize this. "They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him." You hear that song? We sing that sometimes. This is where it's from. That should be our prayer every night. I pillow my head at night. I live to see that pillow when I close my eyes, because of the mercy of God, is that what he says? Because of the compassion of God did not fail. He didn't run out of compassion that day for me. His mercy and compassion will be there in the morning. Why? Because great is his reliability. My Bible says faithfulness. The Lord is all I need, so the Lord is all I hope in. That's the message of Jeremiah. That's the message we should take to our beds every night. And thus, at the end of the day, we can reflect on how it was a day the Lord made. At the end of the week, we can renew ourselves to worship him on Sunday. At the end of the year, we can resolve to put the past behind us to make a new one even better. Finally, at the end of the hour, which is what we're approaching, at the end of this hour of worship, at the end of the hour, respond. Forget this year. Forget this last week of the year. Forget the whole rest of the day you may have, maybe not, for the rest of this Sunday. Right here, right now, you are here. What is your relationship with Christ like right now? This hour is ending. I mean, it's only 1:40, but this hour of worship is ending. This time together is coming to a close. There may not be another one. I've been talking about teaching this Isaiah class on Wednesday night. I may die tonight. We may all die together tonight. There could be an epidemic that breaks out, or there could be a war that breaks out, or the Lord himself could come from the clouds. You may not live to see tonight or tomorrow morning. Don't be so naive as to think you are guaranteed to make it to your home when you leave here. Don't be so arrogant as to think you're entitled to another day, another week, or another year. All you have is right now, this moment, this hour, what you can do with him. And you're right with God? Our sermon's title is The End. We're about to sing a song, an invitation song, inviting you to obey, so that when the end comes for you or for all of us, you're ready. Are you ready? At this hour, are you ready? If you're not, repent, change your life, be baptized, obey Christ, Acts 2:38. For the remission of your sins. We're inviting you to get your life right with God. If you're a sin-struggling Christian, repent and pray for strength and forgiveness. Acts 8:22. Let us know if we can help you. Let us know right now as we stand and sing.